It's the Hero Show. Welcome to the Hero Show, everybody. Starring the irrepressible Andrew Bernstein and the remorseless Robert Begley. I am Andrew Bernstein, and you are indubitably Robert Begley. How you doing today, Robert?
I'm doing great, Andy. I thought you were going to call me a royalist today because this is one of the first episodes we're going to talk about royalty. British royalty is the subject of today's episode.
Well, I was never a big fan of royalty, British or otherwise. And now we have these outcasts, you know, kind of crawling around America, the two of them. I don't know what, you know, Harry and Meghan, is that, you know. You know, as far as I'm concerned, they can head back to the UK anytime they want.
Yeah,
I'll help.
I think Bugs Bunny captured it best when there's one episode when he's with the, you know, the British royal guy and he's talking about all the nobility and the kings and queens and Bugs says, well, in America, we have royalty. We have Duke of Ellington, Count of Basie, Earl of Hines, Satchmo of Armstrong. And he's like upstarts and rogues. So that's the difference here between how America sees royalty and not just the Brits. They didn't invent it. Every other European country did. But the Brits, they were better than others in that sense. I'll just say that much.
Without a doubt. You know, without a doubt, the principle of individual rights comes out of
yes.
British culture, and there's a strong tradition there of freedom and opposition to totalitarian states, and our heroine for today certainly embodies that, right?
Yes,
Katharine of Atholl, the Duchess of Atholl, little known, but we're gonna do what we can to remediate that. I want to give some credit to our good friend Larry Reed, who's an economist by training and profession, former head of FEE, the Foundation of Economic Education. His book, Real Heroes, Inspiring True Stories of Courage, Character, and Conviction, is an excellent book. I strongly recommend it. He's got this. Any number of heroes in their short, you know, several page vignettes on any number of heroes, some of them very well known, others little known, like the Duchess of Atholl, some who don't belong in any book on heroes, like St. Augustine, as far as I'm concerned.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I want to credit you, Andy, because you told me about this book. And I have to admit, 3 weeks ago, I never heard of Katharine, the Duchess of Atholl, and reading her story is inspiring, and it's something people should know. Larry Reed calls her a modern day Cassandra, and if you know Greek mythology, Cassandra was the one she had was able to foresee like prophecies and tell people, warn people about them, but unfortunately they never listened to her. So there's something wrong with that Trojan horse, she would say, and no, we don't, just go away. We don't care. So I think that's a good description of the Duchess of Atholl there, because she saw evil in the world and called it out. But also she upheld freedom and individuality. So it wasn't only that she was against, she was also in totally in favor of liberty here.
Yes. Yeah. Born in 1874 in Scotland.
Yep.
Died 1960. Obviously,
full life.
Yes, yeah, lived to be 85. She was a pianist and a composer. It's interesting. Yes. They say, her name, I think her family name was Catherine Ramsey, but she married.
Yes.
What was his name? Stuart Murray or Murray
Duke.
Stuart?
Duke Stuart Murray. Yes.
Stuart Murray, who ascended to the dukedom on the death of his father years later.
Right.
And so his wife, Catherine Stuart Murray, became the Duchess of Atholl. It's an interesting arc in her life, Robert, because she opposed women's suffrage, you know, as a
Amazing,
younger woman.
Yeah.
She didn't think women should have the right to vote. And then she ends up becoming, you know, one of the first women. Was she the first woman elected to Parliament from Scotland? She was certainly one. She was certainly one of the first.
Yes, in the Conservative Party, or Tories, as they call them as well. And yeah, the first one from Scotland, Edinburgh. We said is where she's from. First, she went to school, high school in Wembley, and then She studied music as well before gaining notoriety. And one thing I learned, Andy, was that she would compose music to poetry, Robert Louis Stevenson's poetry. I tried to do a search. I tried to find something that I could listen to kind of, get a firsthand feel for what she wrote, but I'm unable to find that. So, but yeah, even before going into politics, she had, it wasn't until she was in her 30s, 40s that she actually got into politics.
Yeah, and they say she was kind of diffident, maybe a little bit shy. She wasn't mm-hmm. Early in her life, she wasn't real extroverted or assertive. The men in Parliament just expected her to to just follow orders, in effect, just obey, be a retiring kind of non-assertive woman. Mm-hmm. Churchill's initial reaction was something like, I find a woman in Parliament as intrusive as if she came into my bathroom or something. He said something like that. He said, but he came to realize, a few years later, just how important a person and how far seeing and how insightful Katharine of Atholl was. So mm-hmm. She becomes it's just the transformation is fascinating, from a woman who didn't think women should vote to a member of Parliament. You're elected to Parliament. Yeah. That's one thing. But from a mm-hmm. kind of quiet, retiring, artsy musician to this assertive firebrand, against totalitarianism across the European continent, it's an extraordinary transformation and a very heroic one, especially for a woman back then who expected to just be quiet and do what the men in Parliament tell, the men in the Conservative Party tell her to do.
Yeah. And what were most of the men in Parliament saying? Appeasement. The problem will go away. Over and over again, she faced this appeasement, none more than from Chamberlain. And but if we go kind of chronologically, the first totalitarian state that she thoroughly opposed was the Russian Revolution, 1917, and she writes about it in 1931. She wrote about its effects, including the starvation of Ukrainians. Yeah, you want to take something from there, Andy?
Larry Reed in Real Heroes, he talks about this, exactly what you said, Robert. In in 1931, Atholl published The Conscription of a People. Nice title, right?
Yes.
To describe a totalitarian state. And Lawrence Reed describes it, a blistering, well-documented indictment of the savage collectivization of life in the Soviet Union. Quote from Katharine Atholl's book: Russia has carried through revolution on a scale which knows no parallel, and which even after 13 years is as ruthless as in its early days. She has undermined marriage and is rapidly breaking up family life. She wages a ceaseless war on all religion. She is responsible for the most comprehensive and continuous experiment in the nationalization of industry, banking, and trade that has ever been seen. Unquote from Conscription of a People. Now, quoting from Real Heroes, Lawrence Reed writes, Atholl's book was one of the earliest and most detailed critiques of the communist regime from a high-level British official. Forced labor, of course, is a euphemism for slavery. Liquidation of the kulaks, there's the Ukrainian terror famine, or the Holodomor, Holodomor, I'm not sure how to pronounce it, but 4 to 10 million Ukrainians deliberately starved to death by Stalin. 1932-33. Mass seizures of property, an extensive secret police network, and an unprecedented diversion of resources to the military meant one thing. The Bolsheviks were a menace to their own people and a growing threat to world peace. Larry Reed continues. Wow. The Duchess decried the British government's extension of credit to Moscow. Quote, "Can those in any country who value liberty regard such a position with equanimity?" she asked. "Are the citizens of the United Kingdom in particular to tolerate any longer the guaranteeing by taxpayers' money of a system so utterly repugnant to British traditions?" Unquote from from Katharine Atholl. The rats, like the way Larry Reed put, the rats in Moscow were alarmed at Atholl's denunciation. Who was this Scottish Cassandra who dared so publicly to question the subsidies coming their way from the government of her own party? So the Conservatives were subsidizing the Soviets. And Catherine Atholl, Duchess of Atholl, recognized this is a brutal totalitarian state. This is everything they stand for is inimical to British, to British love of liberty and and individual rights. And she stood up against the members of her own party. Cost her later on with the rats in Berlin, as Larry Reed put it. But she took a principled stand against the rats in Moscow.
Yeah, Andy, it's fabulous the way Larry Reed phrases that. He paints a real vivid picture, including with this analogy of a rat. She could smell a rat. That's how he kind of sets her up. You can smell a rat and call it out, which is what she did. 2 years later, 1933, she goes on to the BBC. This is the one place I found. There's like a 6-minute speech on YouTube, read by somebody else, but it's her words. And what she's calling out the BBC for their biased, their pro-Soviet, their whitewashing of, how rare is this, Andy, right? First time it ever happened, right? Where the media is whitewashing some kind of evil and propping them up saying, no, this is a noble experiment that's happening in Russia. And we have seen the future. And she says, you're only telling one side of the story, and you should be fair, and you should give the other side. And guess what? I have a lot of data. Facts are important in this matter, and I have a lot of data. And so this is the BBC in 1933 that already not only the politicians but the media is sucking up to these totalitarian states.
Right. Right. And to this day they still do, to communist communist regimes like China, for example. Yeah. But
exactly.
Yeah, yeah. So in 1933, the National Socialist rats come to power in Berlin. And Katharine Atholl, Katharine Atholl immediately recognizes the dangers, and she points this out to Churchill. And and Larry Reed makes good point in this chapter that Churchill has a justified reputation of being an early critic of Hitler, an early opponent of Hitler when others wanted to appease Hitler, but Katharine Atholl was ahead even of him. She recognized evidently she was fluent in German. I take it she read.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
She read the full version of Mein Kampf. Yep, and sent it to him. And the outer world saw the watered down version. She says it was 1/3 the size of the English translation of Mein Kampf, and all the stuff about the Jews and Hitler's intentions were largely covered up in the version that went out to the public. But in the German version, in his own country, he was explicit about it.
Right, right. And she sent him the full German version of Mein Kampf, Hitler's book. If people aren't aware, Hitler wrote a book, Mein Kampf, I think in English that means My Struggle. I think when he was he was in prison in the 1920 something for the Munich, was for the beer hall putsch. Was it in Munich? It might have been in Munich. But it was when he was in prison. And he lays out the platform for the National Socialist Workers' Party of Germany, what their intentions are. And he was brutally honest. He didn't whitewash or soft smoke it, soft soap it. He said what the Nazis intended to do. And you're right. Evidently, the English translation, somebody in the UK, the publishing house or whatever, must have said, maybe, I don't know, maybe we'll sell more copies if we don't, you know, if we had a shorter version, if we cut out all the atrocities to get tense. I don't know. But what was responsible for that? But she sent Churchill the full version. This is who Hitler is. And later on, you know, when Hitler's speeches were not available outside of Germany, Katharine Atholl, you know, got copies of those of Hitler's speeches, where again he was fulminating on what he intended, the atrocities he intended to perpetrate, and got those copies to Churchill. So Churchill knew exactly who Hitler was, and Katharine Atholl prodding the powers that be in the UK to know who these SOBs are and to stand up to them.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah.
Yeah. That is, you know, just that enough, Andy, to reach out to a man, Churchill, who we covered his gigantic heroism, and knowing that she had an impact there, such a, you know, positive impact. And it's also important to him to know that he's not alone, because so much of, you know, as we covered in his story, it just seemed like everybody was against Churchill when he made these difficult decisions. But he knew that here's a principled person who actually upholds and defends liberty and knows the evil of the threat of the Nazi threat, the current Nazi threat. But even at that, I mentioned this earlier, Andy, wherever there was a dictatorship, she went there. She wanted to see it and call it out. So Spain, Italy, the fascist Mussolini, the Brits were sucking up to him. They thought they could negotiate with him, and she's calling that out. And then even eventually she goes to call out the socialist welfare state within the UK. So just far ahead of her time, seeing the damage of these kinds of policies, both domestic and in foreign policy.
Right, right. And I like the way, again, go back to real heroes here. And by the way, another plug, Larry Reed's book, he makes it clear right at the beginning of this book that the most important characteristic of heroism is moral character. You know, it's not military prowess, but moral character is the most important aspect. Mm-hmm. But listen to this. She's talking about Larry Reed's talking about the powerful British politicians. And he writes, they sought to placate Mussolini in Italy and Franco in Spain. Atholl saw all fascist dictators the same way she saw all communist dictators, as evil men not to be trusted, let alone subsidized. She was a constant thorn in the side of the men in power, wanted to cut deals with unsavory thugs. Biographer Sheila Hetherington notes that by 1935, Atholl, quote, had become seriously worried not only about Britain's defenses, but about the attitude of mind of the country's leaders. This supineness, which means lying passively on your back. Their supineness, their complacency, their willingness to overlook the brutality of fascism, while making public speeches deploring the actions of the dictators, making no move to deter them, and even making friendly overtures to them, unquote, from her biographer, Sheila Hetherington. So, she's opposed to Franco and Mussolini, you know, as well as to Hitler and Stalin. So, you know, the real showdown with the powers that be in the Conservative Party and the British government comes over, you know, the Peace in Our Time, you know, accord, Neville Chamberlain. Yeah, mm-hmm. You're right. 1938, mm-hmm. Neville Chamberlain, Conservative and British Prime Minister, head of her own party and head of the government that she's working for, cuts a deal with Hitler. Granting Hitler the Sudetenland, right, part of Czechoslovakia, mm-hmm. Hitler of course promises no more expropriation of land. We're done. We'll live peacefully, you know. And Chamberlain mm-hmm. believes him, you know, and comes back, you know, to Britain, getting off the plane on the tarmac, waving the agreement, saying the famous words, "Peace in our time." And a lot of people, you know, applaud. Hitler's been placated. War in Europe is averted. Chamberlain's a great, you know, diplomat and everything. But Katharine Atholl was not in agreement with this. She was not to be fooled by Hitler's promises, was she?
No. No, not at all. Andy, it kind of reminds me in the movie Team America when Hans Brix comes to meet Kim Jong-il, and he's like, if you don't let us check, you know, your facilities, we're going to get very angry. It's like, what are you going to do? We're going to write you a nasty letter. It's like, we're not going to do anything militarily because we have no backbone, but we're going to write you a nasty letter. And that's what Chamberlain was. You know, he's saying, oh, peace in our time. And if you take Czechoslovakia, and we'll write you a nasty letter. You know, and if you take Poland, you know, we'll turn the other cheek, you know, and she was having no part of that. But unfortunately, he had more power at the time. And when she
he was the head of the conservative yeah. party. Mm-hmm. He was the prime minister of Britain, and he was a man, you know, and it's still that, you know, that
three things. Yeah. That, three that, things in his favor. Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. There's still that mentality mm-hmm. that women should be, you know, subordinate. And here again, the great transformation. She was evidently, you know, somewhat shy and retiring in her youth, but not now. She is a firebrand, you know, for freedom and against totalitarianism. And I think, you know, Larry Reed describes this beautifully, Robert. Mm-hmm. Chamberlain's September 1938 Munich agreement with Hitler has become synonymous with appeasement. And I want to say something, you know, on behalf of Chamberlain here, although he's obviously egregiously mistaken. They showed this very nicely in that great film, Darkest Hour.
Yes, they did.
Which, yeah.
They portrayed him very nobly. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, yeah. I'm trying to remember who was the actor who played Churchill in Darkest Hour. He won
Anthony, best. Was it Anthony Hopkins?
No, it wasn't Anthony Hopkins. It was somebody like that.
Oh, the one who did Beethoven.
Yeah, it was Gary something.
Gary Oldman.
Yeah, Gary Oldman, who I think won Best Actor for that portrayal. And if so, deservedly so. And if you guys haven't seen Darkest Hour, I strongly recommend
it.
Joe Wright directed it.
Definitely.
It's a great, great film. But they show Chamberlain and his buddy Halifax, you know, the appeasers here. These guys, you know, sincerely desire peace, and understandably so. And they point out to Churchill, you know, these guys were all old enough to have been, you know, in World War One. You were there, Winston. You remember the bloodbath, the horrors of it. You wanna, you know, all these young men being slaughtered on both sides. You wanna go back, you know, go back to that? And of course, the answer is no. Nobody wants that kind of. No good person wants that. That kind of horror. Peace is a noble, you know, value. War is hell, as Sherman put it so nicely. Mm-hmm. But the key error, of course, the key error on the part of the appeasers, Chamberlain and Halifax. So Halifax says to Churchill in the film in Darkest Hour, he says to him, Hitler will be reasonable. You know, and Churchill goes apoplectic. He said, Hitler is not reasonable. You know, when will we learn? How many dictators must we appease before we understand you cannot reason with a tiger when your head is in its mouth? You know, it's just, and there's
the perfect analogy. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And there's the key error on the part of Chamberlain, Halifax, and their supports. Hitler will be reasonable. No, he will not be reasonable. And power lusters typically are not reasonable. The more you give to them, the more they sense weakness, and the more they're ready to take. And Katharine Atholl recognized that. She stood up against her own party. And, you know, the Chamberlain's agreement with Hitler has become synonymous with appeasement. It allowed Hitler to incorporate forcibly the Sudetenland a Czech region along the border with Germany into the Third Reich. But when Chamberlain waived the agreement on the tarmac on returning to London and declared peace in our time, much of the world breathed a sigh of relief. War seemed to have been averted. Catherine Atholl's husband and others strongly advised her to endorse the Munich Accord. The Duchess not only refused to do so, she also wrote and widely distributed a pamphlet that castigated the agreement. He's got even against her own husband, who was a member of the Conservative Party. I mean, how much strength of character does that take? Stand up to the Prime Minister, stand up to the head of the Conservative Party, stand up to my husband, stand up to all the men, in Parliament who expect a woman to simply go along with what the men have decided. Wow, this is impressive. This is
an Ayn Rand novel, right, Andy? It's like right out of an Ayn Rand novel.
Yeah.
Yeah, even your own lover, you're fighting a battle against.
Sometimes, presumably his attitude was, we're members of the Conservative Party. This is the leader of the party, the head of the government. And who knows? Maybe he's right. Maybe peace is an enormous value. War has been averted, at least temporarily. Maybe war has been averted permanently. Give peace a chance, right? To coin a phrase.
Another part.
But Catherine Atholl recognized this is Hitler we're dealing with. He will not honor his agreements.
Yeah, that is so perceptive and also reminds me of Ayn Rand. What did she say that, I can only paraphrase it, I don't know the quote inside out. I'm not brave enough to be silent, I see the consequences too clearly, right? Or I'm not courageous enough. Something like that, where Ayn Rand knows she must speak out, where silence implies agreement. And that's exactly what Catherine was, facing in her life, frankly, earlier than Ayn Rand. Well, Ayn Rand was doing her own speaking out right around the same time, but she was younger.
Yes.
Yeah, it's interesting, her dates, Catherine's dates, but Catherine's dates, they're somewhat around Churchill's. She was a little bit younger and died only 5 years earlier than him. So they lived when Britain was great, and they, the arc of it going from Great Britain to simply Britain, the world changed over the course of her 85 years and Britain's place in it, largely because of things she fought. Her ideals were being just cast aside, and if we just continue this Chamberlain's impact on her, which Larry Reed covers, it was she was up for re-election. Go ahead, you want to?
Yeah, let's let Larry Reed tell the story because he does a great job. Mm-hmm. Prime Minister Chamberlain reacted furiously. He strong-armed the local Conservative Party officials in Scotland to select a new candidate for Parliament to replace Atholl. She resigned from the party and announced she would run as an independent in the special by-election set for December 1938. The country's attention was riveted by the fierce campaign that ensued. The prime minister saw to it that Atholl's opponent received showers of cash and endorsements, and he employed every trick possible to stop the Duchess. In the words of one historian, it was, quote, one of the dirtiest by-election campaigns of modern times. Unquote. Facing threats from Chamberlain and the party whip, even anti-appeasement conservatives wouldn't go to Scotland to campaign for the Duchess. Churchill first accepted an invitation to speak on her behalf, but then under pressure rescinded. As Olson reports in her book, he instead sent a letter of endorsements that she distributed before the voting. Churchill wrote, quote, "You are no doubt opposed by many conservatives as loyal and patriotic as yourself, but the fact remains that outside our island, your defeat at this moment would be relished by the enemies of Britain and of freedom in every part of the world. It would be widely accepted as another sign that Great Britain no longer has the spirit and willpower to confront the tyrannies and cruel persecutions which have darkened this age," unquote, from Churchill. It's Churchill's brilliant writing style, right?
Yes.
"The tyrannies and cruel persecutions which have darkened this age." Back to Larry Reed's text here. She lost by a heartbreakingly slim margin. Chamberlain was delighted. even if the razor-thin margin of victory hardly counted as a ringing endorsement of his appeasement policy. When Hitler invaded Poland less than 9 months later, Kitty Atholl was vindicated. A humiliated Chamberlain sulked through the remaining few months of his tenure. Unquote from Larry Reed. Wow.
It's justice. And, you know, Chamberlain got what was coming to him, and appeasement is not practical if enough people have a backbone, and she was certainly one of them. And Churchill himself, you know, this is, as we talked about during his episode and in the film Darkest Hour, it was like they were out of options. They were really out of options of appeasement. Just was not working, and the fear of the German, you know, onslaught was like right in front of them, and she stood for that, but that was it for her as far as politics goes. That was like the last straw she realized a disgusting, you know, one of the dirtiest, you know, elections in history. And she was the victim of it. And she's like, yeah, I'm taking my ball and going home. That's that.
Yeah. And she spent the rest of her life, her long life, you know, doing other things. I mean, she was instrumental in helping, you know, European refugees, who are victims of the war. She composed music and played the piano. Her life, you know, she had the relationship with her husband. I'm not sure if they had children or not. I don't remember, but
none that I know of, none that are described, at least in the short biographies. But one thing, Andy, Larry, also one more thing I'd like you to read is the positive. There's a great quote he has about liberty and individual ingenuity, and how that, you know, this is, again, so far we're hearing her stand against totalitarianism and compromise and appeasement, but that's often not enough. You need to be for something, and and I think it's with words of wisdom from blurb.
Yeah, you're right, Robert. On page 158 of Real Heroes, Larry Reed, words of wisdom from Katharine Atholl. Quote, "I stand for a great cause, the particular essence of which rested on freedom and goodwill. Freedom for the fullest possible development of private initiative and industry, as opposed to a system that would give the state control. Freedom of career for the development of the individual, as opposed to a system which would make for a rigid uniformity in all persons," unquote. Katharine Atholl.
Yeah, that's the positive there. And she sees that. She sees, and I'm sure she looked at British history where the upholding of the individual rights to the degree that it was more in Britain than anywhere else in Europe. And that led to their success. And she saw that and identified that vocally as well. And that, to me, that's a big takeaway from of her life, because, you know, as I just said, it's really important to condemn evil, but in my mind, it's even more important to praise the good. And that's what she's doing here.
Ah, absolutely right. And that's one of the one of many principles in the objectivist ethics that I love, you know, that it's more important to reward the good than it is to fight the evil. Mm-hmm. I think, you know, Leonard Peikoff in Opar talks about, you know, yes, Kant must be, you know, denounced and attacked for his errors, but it's much more important to uphold Aristotle and recognize that Aristotle, you know, saw the truth and was right in so many fundamental issues.
Life depends on that. Our life depends on the good and finding good value and joy and success and happiness and the requirements. And it seems like that Katharine saw that, you know, she saw that as well in her life. And she was active in, just if we look at pro-life, you know, pro-human life, in helping any kind of suffering wherever it took place. I think also some girls, club. She was an active member. Like the last six decades of her life, she was really active there as well. So it's interesting your first point about her, you know, being anti-suffrage. But she knew that women's empowerment was, I mean, here's a role model who is also speaking out about that in a society, you know, that did not really have that, you know, aside from the Queen in Britain, there's not too many other females that that come to your mind as these towering figures.
Yeah. You know, and you grow up in a society, you had a certain culture. So she's late 19th century, Victorian era, Scotland.
Yes.
Presumably, yeah. You know, the culture was conservative. It had long opposed women's suffrage. Mm-hmm. Presumably she's immersed in that growing up, you know, and accepts mm-hmm. it. But, you know, as she matures, she comes to realize, wait a minute. wait a minute. What if, you know, what if there's a lot of good men, you know, male, but what if none of them are willing to stand up to the Hitlers and the Stalins and the Mussolinis and the Francos? And what if it's a woman who wants to do it? You know, then, you know, Well, women have one of these too, you know, and women have yes. moral backbone and principles. And, you know, mm-hmm. I'm not sure the genesis of her transformation on this, but looking at her biography, you know, it makes sense that she's one of the few mm-hmm. voices willing to speak out against the bad guys who are terrorizing Europe, you know, in her lifetime and stand up for, you know, for British principles of individual rights and liberties, then by God, then the women have to do it. You know, yeah. It's morally mm-hmm. right to do it. And you can see why she would, you know, change her mind on that position and
right.
even, you know, run for parliament and be, you know, and be elected, presumably. So, you know, by that time, run for parliament and be elected. So you could see why, you know, given her views on liberty and anti-totalitarianism, you can see why she would change her mind. Liberty, individual liberties would include the rights to vote, you know, for not just mm-hmm. for men, but for women. So she became mm-hmm. she became a consistent supporter of individual rights. And I give her credit because she probably had to overthrow a great deal of her upbringing and, you know, a great deal of her, you know, her, yeah. of her early training in order to do so.
Mm-hmm. And she continued on in the 40s, campaigning against the Soviets in Poland and Czechoslovakia. So it wasn't as if, you know, after the World War II was over, she just continued on and then, yeah, lived out the rest of her life. Just being outspoken wherever she had a platform, even if it wasn't necessarily an office. So she stayed consistent through the end of her days. And kudos to Larry Reed for digging up this
yeah.
person. Because yeah. as I said, I, you and I, Andy, we're always on the lookout for heroes. And knowing this was the nicest find in this book. He has some others that we'll get to eventually, but this was, for me personally, it was like, wow, that's what a story. And again, even yeah. the way he phrases it, bringing her back to Cassandra, to the ancient Greeks, like someone who saw and tried to warn people, but was somewhat pushed aside for that.
Yep. Yeah, I wanted to thank Larry Reed, you know, for this also, because his book, you know, was published a few years ago, and, you know, I got a copy and read it, and there's a whole bunch of heroes and heroines in here that I didn't know about. There's some who are famous, some who are not famous, you know, most mm-hmm. of them with great stories. And I had never even heard of Katharine Atholl until I read,
yeah.
until I read, you know, Real Heroes a few years ago. So, you know, and I think, you know, when I was ready to publish Heroes, Legends, Champions, Why Heroism Matters, I, you know, I got a blurb mm-hmm. from Larry Reed, you know, for that book. And I think the two books complement each other nicely, because Heroes, Legends, Champions is a philosophic book, you know, arguing for what's the nature of heroes and what does it mean to be a hero? And Larry Reed's mm-hmm. book fills in with a whole range of instances, you know, showing
yeah.
you know, showing stories of many, you know, illustrates the principle, and shows that character above all is what makes for heroism. So I think the two books, complement each other nicely. One theoretical, one practical. One filled with principles, the other filled with examples. Mm-hmm. Principles explain the examples illustrate the principles. I think they go together nicely. But also, coming back to our heroine for today, you know, free will at work, right? Because, you know, who'd have thunk it? The people who knew her in her youth, you know, this quiet, artsy, retiring girl, you know, pianist and composer and everything, becomes this tigress in support of, you know, individual liberties and opposition to totalitarianism. Wow, you know, what a growth.
In her character. That's the heroic arc, Andy, as well. It's like a lot of heroes don't look for it. It's kind of presented to them. You know, they would rather just be doing their, you know, dealing with their day-to-day goals and ambitions, and then things are thrust upon them. And it took her a long time. You know, it took her until she's in her 40s and 50s and has seen a lot of life, but seen the transition of the early 20th century move towards totalitarian states. And so with the data that she had, she couldn't stay quiet about it. She smelled a rat and called it out. And I you know, even that is, I like the way Larry even presents that. It's like, she was on, again, wherever there's totalitarianism, I'm sign me up. I'm in, and I want to speak out about it. I want as much data, as much evidence, and then I'll present it to the world, for whatever that's worth.
You cannot get any more principled than she was in her opposition to Chamberlain's, you know, Munich Accord with Hitler, because she went against. Yeah, like she went against the head of her own party. She went against the prime minister. She went against her own husband's advice. She went against all these, you know, all these men in parliament. Put her own career on the line. You know, in effect, she got, you know, deplatformed, if I can use it, through a defrocked.
Yeah, she did.
By Chamberlain, you know, within her own party, he used his clout to remove her from the candidacy, and you know, she had to run as an independent. You know, she put her political career on the line for her principles, and you know, it doesn't get any more morally upright than that.
Yeah, great point, Andy, and also your point about the moral character that Larry Reed focuses on. I mean, that's the theme. You and I do not cover a hero. That moral character is not a dominant part of their life, whatever foibles they have, whatever inconsistencies they have. The part that we celebrate is that moral character, which leads them to achieve these gigantic, to deal with these gigantic adversities and become successful.
Right. And I think, you know, Katharine Atholl deserves much more recognition than she has achieved. So, so Larry Reed's inclusion of her, the chapter on her in the book, is a step in the right direction. The hero show, maybe hopefully is at least a small step in getting some of the recognition for this heroine, that, that she so abundantly deserves. And I can say in America today, it's scary. The political left has just set up a Ministry of Truth in the Department of Homeland Security, which is a law enforcement agency, so that, you know, the government now gets to decide what's truth and, you know, what's falsehood, which is censorship. And it's a law enforcement agency. So if you or I or anybody, you know, speaks truth that are not supported by the government, does that mean armed law enforcement officers are going to show up at our door, you know, and arrest us? While on the other side, you know, of the political aisle, the conservatives are busy banning abortion. It looks like Roe versus Wade is going to be, we heard that, saw that leak from the Supreme Court, that Roe versus Wade looks like it's going to be overturned and thrown back to the states. And of course, many states then will ban the right to abortion, which is certainly mm-hmm. early in the pregnancy. That's where there's no rational case you can make that a fetus is a human being. That's an egregious violation of a woman's right to her own body. So from both sides, the two major parties, the only ones that have any realistic chance of winning national elections, we're being pushed yeah. towards dictatorship. So Katharine Atholl's example today is even more relevant. It's even more pertinent.
More relevant. Up. Yeah, we need many more of her. We need many more of her types to change the tide here, because it is a grim picture, Andy. I mean, Ministry yeah. of Truth, isn't that out of Ayn Rand's anthem?
They're not calling it that, but that's what it is. That's what
yeah.
it is.
Yeah.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I think it's out of 1984. It's the same. It's the same grim picture. And it's not and bad enough that there's such a thing, to monitor what people are saying or writing, but that it's part of a law enforcement agency makes it even more baleful.
Yeah,
that means mm-hmm. armed law enforcement officers might show up at your house to arrest you for speaking, for making claims that are not supported by the government, or making claims that clash with government propaganda. So we live in perilous times, and here's where I'm tempted to say, just forget about politics now. It's hopeless. Both sides are so bad. It's just hopeless. Just cultivate my garden, like Voltaire said. Live out my life. Make love, spend time with my daughter, write books and essays on other topics and everything. But at this, another countervailing voice in my head is like Katharine Atholl's, are yes. we going to give up the country to dictatorship? Are we going to give up the freest country in history to the dictators or the violators of individual rights from both sides? And I'm this is where we need the inspiration of real heroines like Katharine Atholl, and I'm glad. It's funny, it's appropriate that we should discuss her today, where the Ministry yeah. of Truth has just been established a few days ago, and then the leak from the Supreme Court that Roe versus Wade was going to be overturned was yesterday. Mm. So it's very appropriate.
Well, just like in 1933 when she spoke out on the BBC about the BBC's clear bias towards Soviet Russia and their blindsidedness and not even reporting the other side. That's similarly, that's one of the things we're doing here, is letting people know that, yeah, there is a pro-liberty stance that we are upholding. And just the way that she did back in, throughout the course of her life, but specifically on the media, on the BBC, we're using whatever channels we can similarly today.
Yes. Yes. So I think we have done justice to Katharine of Atholl, a heroine who deserves much more recognition than she has received. And all hero worship is, again, I'll point out.
Yeah, mine too.
Yes. Yes. I'll point out Larry Reed's book is very good on well-known yeah. heroes and lesser-known heroes, and we shall revert to this book again, in the fullness of time, mm-hmm. because there's a lot of people here who've achieved notable things that are little known. Some who are well-known, like Larry Reed has a chapter on Jesse Owens, the great,
We'll get to him for sure. Yeah. yeah.
Mm-hmm. We'll definitely do a mm-hmm. hero show episode on
Same
Jesse
era.
Owens. Yeah. Yeah, that's right. That's right. 1930s as Hitler was in power in Germany. We'll definitely do an episode on him and a number. Was it Nicholas Winton, the British, was a businessman, right? Who rescued a bunch yeah. of Jewish kids from the Nazis, in Europe. There's a,
right.
Who's not, not that well known, but deserves to be. There's a whole mm-hmm. there's a whole litany of this the book's a gold mine, of yeah. heroes. So we shall mm-hmm. and succinct. The stories are succinct. They're uplifting, and again, they emphasize character above all. Like Martin Luther King said, character, not color of skin or anything.
That's right.
Not gender, not race, not nationality. Character, and you know, Larry Reed shows that beautifully in his book, his book, Real Heroes. So,
great.
I think we can salute the Duchess, the pretty girl, you know, and the musician who became a firebrand for freedom. Thank you, Miss Dutchess of Atholl. Thank you, Larry Reed, for bringing that story to our attention. And I think we could say to everybody out there in Hero Land, I hope, you know, you lead have a heroic day. And for all of us, let's strive to lead more heroic lives like the Dutchess of Atholl. So, Robert,
yes,
we could say adieu, you know, or au revoir, I guess, would be until we meet again, because we will be back next week once again on the Hero Show. See you next week, everybody.
See you then.